In this module, we have seen so far that sigma f equal to d over dt mv, which is Newton's second law, can be written as integral sigma f dt equal to change in linear momentum, right? And this defines our momentum impulse method for solving problems. The quantity on the left-hand side is called impulse or linear impulse, and the quantity on the right-hand side is called change in momentum, right? So this is change momentum, okay? And this relationship that we have is analogous to what we obtained in module 4 in the work energy approach, which said that the work done by a force, which is integral f dx, is equal to change in kinetic energy, right? So if you think of left-hand side as the cause, so you apply a force on a particle, and the particle is displaced by some amount, let's say delta x, and there's a change in linear velocity, then the cause is the application of the force over a distance, which gave rise to change in kinetic energy, right? Which reflected as change in velocity. Similarly, over here in this module, we have a force applied over a period of time or an interval, and that gives rise to linear impulse or impulse. So that can be seen as a cause, and that results into an effect, which is change in momentum, right? And remember, both of these relationships are coming from Newton's second law. So we're not really creating a new principle, but we are just restating the Newton's second law in different formats, okay? And one of the format may be more suitable for this one kind of problem, another format may be more suitable for another kind of problem. Now, momentum impulse method is particularly very useful for the problems where we have an impact, where things collide against each other, crash against each other. So let me give you a simple scenario. So let's say we have a hard surface, and we take a ball and we throw it against this hard surface. So what is going to result after the impact is maybe the motion of the ball, which will be modeled as a particle, going in a certain direction at certain speed, right? So it may be coming in with less velocity v1, making an angle of theta 1 from horizontal, going away with a velocity v2, making an angle theta 2 from horizontal, right? It's not guaranteed that the velocities after the impact would be same as velocities before the impact, or even that it would go away at the same angle as the initial angle of attack, okay? So in a problem like this, some of the questions that we are trying to answer are, what are the post-impact velocities? If you know the pre-impact velocities and the angle at which they come in, or you may be given post-impact velocities, you're looking for pre-impact velocities. But before we can answer those kinds of questions, we need to understand the nature of the forces that act on the particle at the time of impact. So if I ask you, what are the forces acting on this particle at the time of impact? Some of the forces that you would readily identify are, one, the gravity, right? So assume that this is thrown in a vertical plane. So at the time of impact, so this is at the time of impact, the forces are gravity. But then there is also a reaction force, right, from the surface, from the ground, onto the ball or the particle. And what is the direction of that normal force? So you might say that the direction of the normal force is, let's say this, okay? But pretty soon you will see that this is not the only normal force actually acting on the particle. There might be a component of this force in the horizontal direction as well. Not a component of the normal reaction, but there may be another force in the horizontal direction that would result because you have change in velocity after the impact, okay? So there may be a force like this, there may be a force like this, let's call that R, right? Now, if I ask you, what caused the particle to rebound or to go in another direction at a different speed, would you say that is gravity? Well, gravity is definitely not responsible for the change in direction of the travel of the particle, right? Gravity was acting all the time. Before the impact, gravity was acting. Okay, after the impact, the gravity is acting, but gravity is not responsible for this change. And you would say that the change in the velocity or the momentum is actually due to the impact. Now, what is impact? Impact basically gives rise to an impact force. That impact force could be N, could be R, or could be both of them, right? Now, what is the nature of this force? Do we know how the force changes over time when the impact happens? Well, we don't know how the force changes. It's a very short-lived impact, right? You know, maybe the ball is in contact with the surface for a few milliseconds, 1 millisecond to, let's say, 5 milliseconds, anything in between. So it's a very short-lived event, right? It's a very short-lived dramatic event over which the impact force changes. And we don't know how that impact force R or N changes over time. And this is delta T, which could be, let's say, 2 milliseconds, right? We don't know what that variation is. we can definitely compute an average force, right? We have already seen that, which would give us a lower bound for this. But we do know that this force is actually very large in magnitude compared to the forces like gravity. Otherwise, there would not be, you know, a complete change in direction of the motion. So we know that the impact force in this case is something like this. You know, it peaks up over a very short interval. This is delta t equal to, let's say, 2 milliseconds, right? It's a very sharp force that acts over a very short duration. And this kind of force is called an impulsive force. This is an impulsive force. And this kind of force is different from, you know, force of gravity or even elastic forces, because force of gravities are pretty much constant. So if you draw the force of gravity over time, what does it look like? It's this. Right? That's your mg. It's the same at all times. Similarly, if you look at the elastic forces, in elastic forces, of course, change based on their deflection, right? So they're given as, you know, the force itself is given as actually kx, right? So kx is clearly proportional to the x, which means that if you were to plot this, depending on how x was changing, it might look something like this, right? Or if it was decreasing, because x was decreasing, it might look something like this. Right, but you can see more or less the change, the variation in the force is not very dramatic. Right, on the other hand, impulsive forces can be as large as they need to be. In fact, we say, you know, that they can be actually infinite magnetic forces. In reality, there are no infinite magnetic forces, but they can be as large as possible to honor or respect the constraints of the system. So, in case of a ball hitting against a hard surface, the constraint is that the surface is going to retain its shape, right? It's not going to deform. It might deform locally for a bit, but more or less it's going to remain a hard surface, and the ball is going to remain more or less hard, right? So you don't want the ball to actually go through the surface, and that's the constraint essentially over here. Another example would be two, you know, billiards ball or pool ball colliding against each other on the surface of the table. Now they collide, and the impact forces, the impulsive forces, can be as large as possible, but it would ensure that the balls actually don't go through each other, right? So the impulsive forces can be infinite in magnitude or very large in magnitude while honoring the constraints of the system, okay? Now if I were to replace, let's say, you know, this system where we have a ball colliding against a hard surface, what I would do is I'm going to mount this surface actually on some springs, okay? And now I'm going to throw the ball on this, you know, let's say this is a top plate. On this top plate, the ball comes and collides, and it's going to go back at some angle, right? Now, in this case, at the time of impact, what are the forces acting on the ball? Well, you, of course, have the gravity, but then you have a reaction force from the plate that would actually result from the deflection of these springs, right? So this might be, you know, three times, let's say, kx, okay? So this is, spring constant is k, and there are three of these forces acting on the plate. So elastic forces are three times kx. Now the elastic forces are not impulsive because now the ground is pliant, right? The plate is pliant, it can move downward, which means that the impulsive forces are actually going to be proportional to the elastic forces. And this is also a non-impulsive force, right? This is not an impulsive force because if you plot it over time, you know, it doesn't peak up like an impulsive force does. It may be something like this, or it may be something like this, depending on the deflection or the compression, right? So this is also a non-impulsive force. This is also a non-impulsive force. In case of an impact, we are not really interested in non-impulsive forces. We are only interested in looking at the impulsive forces because non-impulsive forces do not give rise to change in linear momentum. And our technique for solving problems in this module is to see if we can somehow conserve linear momentum or not. Okay, if we can conserve linear momentum, then we have some relationship between initial velocity and final velocity. Before we apply momentum-impulse approach to solving problems which have impact in them, let's look at some of the terminology associated with the impact. So one of them is the concept of line of impact. Line of impact. So line of impact is basically a line that you would draw perpendicular to the tangent direction at the time of impact. So if I have a particle A and I have a particle B, and at the time of impact, let's say A and B came, you know, together from opposite direction and impacted, then you can draw a line which would be tangent to the contact point, okay? Or you could draw a plane, okay? So if this was like a 3D scenario, then this would be the tangent plane, tangent plane. Perpendicular to this tangent plane, if you draw a line, okay, so let me draw it in a different color. So this is the line perpendicular to this. This line is called line of action or line of impact. Okay, so in your studies class, you learn something about line of action, which is the direction where the forces are, right? So in fact, line of impact is that line along which the impact forces work. Okay, so that's line of impact for you. Line of impact is just decided by the tangent plane or tangent line, all right? Then we have different kinds of impact. You know, what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a four quadrants, okay? And I'm going to place direct here, and opposite to the direct is oblique. So there's something called direct impact, there's something called oblique impact, and they're opposite of each other. And we have central impact versus eccentric impact. And most of the impacts can be put into one of these quadrants over here. So we can have, you know, direct central impact. So we can have, so if you are in this particular quadrant, so we have direct central impact. We can have direct eccentric impact. We can have central, or let me say oblique central impact, or we can have oblique eccentric impact. Okay, so these are the four possibilities. So when do we see these kinds of impact? So let's say if we have, you know, two particles A and B, all right, and the line, this is the tangent, this is the line of action, right? So or line of impact, you can call it LOI to indicate line of impact. And if this line of impact goes through the center of the two particles, so center of masses of the two particles, then we say this is actually a central impact. So line of action or the line of impact is same as the line that you would have when you join the center of mass of the particles, then it's a central impact. Now by definition, particles have no size or shape, which means that the line of impact has to go through the center of mass. So which means for other particles, you really cannot have anything other than central impact, which means that the eccentric impact, which would be the case when you have particles, so when you have rigid bodies, not particles, rigid bodies, and the center of mass, if you draw a line joining the two center of mass, is not necessarily same as line of impact, okay? So for particles, we are only concerned with the central impact. Now, what is direct part of this direct central impact? Direct says that the pre-impact velocities of the particles are along the same direction as line of impact. So if I have A moving this way and B moving this way, and these are the pre-impact velocity, so I'm going to use minus sign to indicate pre-impact phenomena, and I will use the positive sign to impact post-impact phenomena. So A and B are acting in the direction of line of impact. So if that's the case, then we say it's a direct impact. You would get oblique central impact if the two particles came towards each other with pre-impact velocities that were not necessarily in the direction of line of impact. And this is something that happens with, you know, pool balls, right? So you have two particles A and B, you know, B could be stationary and A could come and hit it at an angle, right? So this is the tangent plane and this is the normal direction, right? And this is your line of impact. Now you can clearly see that VA minus is not necessarily in the same direction as line of impact, as was the case for the direct central impact. So this scenario is called oblique central impact, right? And you can still see that the center of mass are on a line that is same as line of impact, okay? So what is a direct eccentric impact? A direct eccentric impact would be if you have two physical objects, let's say something like this, and this is the tangent line, this is the line of impact, here is the center of mass, okay, of one, let's say this is C1, this is C2, and C1 and C2 when joined together are this line. Clearly you can see that line of impact is not the same as the line joining the center of masses, which means that this is actually an eccentric impact, right? Now the direction of the pre-impact velocities will determine whether it's a direct impact or not. So let's say the pre-impact velocity of A is this way and of B is this way, so clearly both of them are along line of action, and that means it's a direct impact, okay? Now you can probably figure out what oblique eccentric impact would be. You have two physical objects, That's your tangent direction. That's your perpendicular direction. This is your line of impact. And here is the center of mass C1 and C2. So this is not any different from the previous scenario. But now the pre-impact velocities may be, you know, something like this, VA minus. And then this may be coming in like this. That's VB minus. Right? Clearly you can see at least one of the pre-impact velocities is not a long direction of line of impact. So this is an oblique eccentric impact. Okay, so line of impact, the direction along which the forces act, and it's also the direction perpendicular to the tangent. And then we have direct central and oblique central impact for the particles. So for the particles, these are the only two possibilities. So particles, which means that in this particular module, we'll only be concerned with direct central impact and oblique central impact. Okay.